And here, what we are going to do is we are going to now, all those terms that we talked about when we were doing nervous system terms, we are going to kind of utilize those terms, right? If you remember, give me some names of what collection of nerve cell bodies were called. Remember, like I said, the bouquet and where the actual flowers were, think of those as the nerve cell bodies. What were some terms we used for collections of nerve cell bodies? Gray matter, very good. Then nucleus, excellent. Ganglion, excellent. And cortex. Okay. And where the axons of these neurons are collected together, what were some terms that we used? White matter. Tracts, very good. Nerves, okay. So you'll see that we'll be using some of those terms up here. So as a review, remember we talked of the nervous system anatomically. We divided it into central nervous system and peripheral nervous system. So we are going to be doing central nervous system. Since it's the important headquarters, also lies in the central axis of the body, it has to be well protected. So it lies in the dorsal body cavity. You remember when we did the first introductory lecture, we talked of the dorsal body cavity, which consists of the cranial cavity and the vertebral column or the vertebral canal. So here, that's where the brain and the spinal cord lie. Now, these are very hard structures, and the nervous system is very soft. So you can't have a soft structure lying in something very hard, even though it may be protective. So you need to protect it further. So with the result, you have three coverings, and in between two of those coverings, you have fluid present. So it's like there is a water bath with coverings present on the outside of the brain and spinal cord. So that kind of prevents it from damaging itself if it were ever to come in contact with the hard surface of the cranial cavity or the vertebral canal. Let's say there's an accident or something. So these coverings are known as meninges, and we have three of them. As you go from the outside to the inside, they get thinner, they are less strong. So the outermost layer is the strongest and the innermost layer is the thinnest. These are called dura, arachnoid, and pia mater. The word mater comes from mother in German. Dura is extremely thick, fibrous tissue, so an excellent covering on the outside. Arachnoid, from arachnid, which is spider-like. This is a cobwebby kind of a covering, so that's known as arachnoid. And the third, pia, is so intimately attached to the surface of the brain and the spinal cord that you cannot actually separate it. So pia means loving. So it's like loving mother, because it kind of caresses the surface of the brain and spinal cord. Now this, we'll see that the entire brain and the spinal cord actually develop from a tube. So there is a tube which has a cavity, and the walls of the tube have nervous tissue. So initially it is, you know, like a straight tube, and then this tube kind of grows and forms projections. And these get larger, and those projections are known as canals or cavities, and they are known as ventricles, and some places we'll call them canals. And they contain cerebrospinal fluid. And then I just also told you that, the brain and spinal cord are bathed on the outside by fluid as well. So you have cerebrospinal fluid on the outside as well. So you have it bathing the brain and the spinal cord on the outside. You also have a cavity inside the brain and the spinal cord. We call those cavities either ventricles or canals. So there's cerebrospinal fluid inside as well. And you'll see how the inside cavities are connected to this outside space, which is the subarachnoid space where cerebrospinal fluid is present. So let's take a look at that. So this is the primitive nervous tissue being developed. So here is the neural tube with a central cavity, and there is surrounding it is this nervous tissue, very little nervous tissue. This then begins to enlarge and gets dilated in certain areas. Also, as it gets dilated, you can kind of just take a look at these. You have three kind of, these are known as brain vesicles. So we have three brain vesicles. Vesicle means like a you know, you did vesicles when you did the cell, for example. Remember, you had lysosomes and you had Golgi apparatus, which gives out these vesicles. A vesicle really means like a rounded structure which is fluid-filled, okay? So we end up with three vesicles in the beginning. These are called forebrain, midbrain, and hindbrain. And the nervous tissue also begins to enlarge. So it doesn't look so here, but the amount of nervous tissue will also enlarge. Then after this stage, after this primitive brain vesicles, the neural tube begins to kind of develop even further, because now it's going to form the future adult brain. So then you can see what happens is that, you know, it gets little outpouchings here, so it kind of looks a bit like Mickey Mouse. Can you see up there? So these two outpouchings on the side will form the cerebral hemisphere. The area in between will form a structure which is called the diencephalon. And then we have other structures which are formed around. And as this happens, the nervous tissue surrounding these cavities also begin to increase in amount so that more connections are made. So from a primitive single tube like this, notice how it's kind of got a lot of projections. But in any case, you must understand that all of these cavities all communicate with one another because they all arose from a single cavity, right? There was a single tube. This then becomes something like this, and then you finally get this final structure, which is what child is born with. So this is the final structure of the brain. Also notice as some of these areas, these little side outpouchings, as they begin to increase in size, what happens is part of the brain gets buried inside, so you can't see it from the external surface. So, you know, as this gets like really large like this, it kind of buries the diencephalon in the middle. So that's why when you look at this picture here, this is one cerebral hemisphere. There's another one on that side. And this diencephalon, part of an area called the midbrain and a small part of the pons, are all kind of deeply buried inside. So you can't see it unless we kind of take a sagittal section through, and then we'll be able to see these parts. Okay, have you followed? So let's look at the meninges and some of the spaces and what these spaces contain. And what is the function? As I said, the main function is protection. It's because brain and spinal cord are soft tissue, so you want to protect it. In certain areas, especially when related to the brain, one of the meninges, the outermost meninge, forms partitions. And these partitions, again, prevent parts of the brain from hitting against each other, and we'll be taking a look at these partitions. So the outermost layer is dura mater, which is this one here, the outermost layer, extremely tough fibrous tissue. This dura mater actually consists of two layers. So you can see up here, it kind of is shown artificially. There are two layers. So one is intimately attached to the periosteum of the brain, and it's known as the periosteal layer, and the other is called the meningeal layer. So imagine there are two layers. They are attached to each other like this. You really can't separate the two. As is shown here in this image here, it's shown as if you can separate. You really can't separate the two. Now what happens is that in certain areas, here is the outer layer, here is the inner layer of dura mater. They're intimately attached to each other. You can't really separate them. But in certain areas of the brain, a blood vessel is present. So if I take a section, a coronal section, I can show a blood vessel like this. So a blood vessel is present in between the two layers. So what it does is it kind of separates the two layers. Can you see? It'll separate the two layers like this. And then again, the two layers will join back with one another. Do you see that? So here is a section shown like this. So here I've taken a coronal section. So that's why I'm seeing the blood vessel as a section like this. This here you can see the blood vessel is present longitudinally like this. So here are the two layers attached to each other on either side. You can't separate them. But where the blood vessel is present, that is present between the two layers. So there's an outer layer and there's an inner layer, and the blood vessel is present in between. Do you see that? Okay. That's what you see here. So here is this blood vessel which is seen. So this is the outer layer which is opened, the blood vessel. And if I scoop the blood vessel out, I will see this second inner layer of dura mater. Now, in some areas, because we want to prevent the two cerebral hemispheres from hitting against each other, so imagine again in coronal section, if this is one cerebral hemisphere on this side, this is another cerebral hemisphere on this side. If there was nothing to separate them, suppose the skull was hit and, you know, it kind of sort of swooshed around in the cranial cavity, this one could collide, one cerebral hemisphere could collide with the other, right? So what happens is this second layer of dura mater in certain areas, what it does is it actually kind of dips down like this and comes back up. And what it does is it forms a partition between the two cerebral hemispheres. So that these two cerebral hemispheres are now separated by fibrous tissue, preventing them from colliding with one another. So this is a section, if I took a section across like this and I showed it to you. So this is a section somewhat like that. So here is one layer of dura mater. Here is the second layer. Here is the blood vessel in between. And see how the second layer comes down and comes back up. Here's one cerebral hemisphere. Here's the other. So this layer, which has come down like a partition, is separating the two cerebral hemispheres. So if we go back to this picture, if I now look at that partition in a sagittal view, so here is that sagittal view shown. So here is one cerebral hemisphere on this side. So there'll be one cerebral hemisphere on this side, and then there'll be another one on that side. And in between the two, you can see this partition which is present because the dura, the second layer of dura mater, comes down and goes back up, right? So since it kind of looks sickle-shaped and it separates the two cerebral hemispheres, this sickle-shaped partition is known as fox cerebri. Fox means sickle-shaped, cerebri means separating the two cerebral hemispheres. So that is the partition, that one partition, fox cerebri. We also have a part of the brain known as the cerebellum. So there's a part of the brain called the cerebellum. And if we look, here is one cerebral hemisphere. The cerebellum is underneath here, like this. So you want to also separate the cerebral hemisphere from the cerebellum. So therefore, this dura mater, what it does is it goes in and comes back out like that, forming a partition between the cerebrum above or cerebral hemisphere above and the cerebellum below. Since this kind of looks tent-like, it looks like a tent, this part is known as tentorium cerebelli. Tentorium cerebelli. So that's the second partition. So we had fox and we have tentorium. And there's another smaller partition called fox cerebelli, which lies between the cerebellar hemispheres, but that's very small. So we'll just talk about these two main ones. So the idea is that these structures don't collide against each other. So they offer extra protection because of dura mater. The second layer is called arachnoid. It's a very thin, cobwebby layer. So therefore, between the dura outside and the arachnoid in the middle, there will be a space present, which is called the subdural space. Sub meaning below dura mater, because this space lies below dura mater and above the arachnoid. So this space is called subdural space, and it contains a little fluid and some veins as well. So we'll see that it has some veins as well. Now this arachnoid mater, in some areas, this arachnoid mater kind of grows into little projections, which are known as arachnoid villi. So it grows into little projections called arachnoid villi. And these villi actually enter into those venous sinuses which are present between the two layers of dura mater. So these arachnoid villi, they open into these venous sinuses. So you can see these little, squiggly things here. These are those arachnoid villi which are opening into the venous sinuses. They help in the drainage of cerebrospinal fluid. So they help in the drainage of cerebrospinal fluid. When these arachnoid villi are really large, we call them arachnoid granulations. So when arachnoid villi are very, very large, they are known as arachnoid granulations. They still do the same thing. They open into the venous sinuses and they help to pour cerebrospinal fluid into the venous sinuses, and then it's taken away by the veins. The last layer is called pia mater, which, as I said, is intimately attached to the surface of the brain and spinal cord. You cannot separate it. So therefore, between the arachnoid and the pia mater, we will have another space present, which is called the subarachnoid space. This subarachnoid space contains cerebrospinal fluid. Remember I said the brain and spinal cord are bathed by fluid on the outside, like a water bath. That fluid is called cerebrospinal fluid. It lies in the subarachnoid space, and this space also contains blood vessels which go to supply the brain. So these are known as cerebral blood vessels. So here we can only see dura and its partitions. So let's take a section through the brain. So here is the skull, and imagine you take a section through like this. So you've taken a coronal section, you take a section through, and now you're looking at the two hemispheres on either side. You're looking at the skull and all the meninges. So here is the skin of the scalp. Here is the periosteum. Here is the skull bone. And then these two are the layers of dura mater. Remember I said one layer was intimately attached to the skull bone. So that's called the periosteal layer. And the second layer is known as the meningeal layer. So here are those two layers. These two layers are stuck to one another. Notice they are stuck to one another here as well as here. You can't really separate the two layers. But in between, there is a venous sinus which is present, which actually runs along the length of the sagittal suture. So it's kind of running in a lengthwise fashion. So here is that venous sinus. So where the venous sinus is present, the two layers separate from each other. So the periosteal layer is on top and the meningeal layer is below. Also, this meningeal layer, if you remember, I said it goes down and comes back up and forms a partition between the two cerebral hemispheres. So this partition here is known as fox cerebri. Okay? The second, so this space here below the dura mater, this space is called the subdural space. The second layer is this thin layer, which is arachnoid mater. So this thin layer up here, which is arachnoid mater. This arachnoid mater in certain areas, notice how it kind of is forming little projections. These projections are called villi. Villi are really projections which are seen in the small intestine of your digestive tract. Since these resemble those thin finger-like projections, that's why they are also called villi. And when you have a large villus like this, you will call it an arachnoid granulation. Otherwise, you just call it an arachnoid villus. Villus is singular. This then is the third layer. Notice this layer here is the third layer, which is intimately attached to the surface of the brain. It goes into any groove that is seen on the surface. So this layer here is the pia mater. So here, it's labeled up here. So here is the pia mater. So therefore, this space between the arachnoid and pia is the subarachnoid space. This is what is filled with cerebrospinal fluid. It also has these blood vessels. These are cerebral blood vessels. The arteries will supply the brain with oxygen. The veins will carry deoxygenated blood back from the brain and then take it back to the heart. So along with cerebrospinal fluid, you have these cerebral blood vessels which are present. Here is the subdural space. So the subdural space has a little fluid. Plus, it also has these veins, because these cerebral veins connect to this venous sinus which is present. A sinus means a dilated vein. So here, when you see the word sinus, it's just a dilated vein. So you can see how large this vein looks. So it's just dilated. So these cerebral veins actually have connections with the venous sinuses by means of these veins, which are often called bridging veins, because they bridge between one to another. So you can understand if somebody has a skull injury and this vein is torn, what will happen? There will be fluid and venous fluid build up in the subdural space. If, on the other hand, there is bleeding in the subarachnoid space, it can be of venous origin or it can be of arterial origin, because you have both arteries and veins inside the subarachnoid space. Okay? So these were meninges on the outside. And then we saw that we had this cerebrospinal fluid which was present on the outside, bathing the brain and spinal cord. But the cerebrospinal fluid is actually manufactured inside cavities in the brain. And these cavities are those which came from that primitive neural tube. So this primitive neural tube that we talked about, this one here. So when you look at the inside of the brain, though, that primitive neural tube now is actually looks like this. So it has all of these projections connecting to one another, coming somewhere it is flared, somewhere it is narrow. This is in the brain, and this continues with a little canal present in the spinal cord. So these cavities are known as ventricles. In certain parts we will call them canal, like in the spinal cord we call it a canal because it's a very narrow tube. They contain cerebrospinal fluid as well. So let's take a look at these names of these cavities. So the cavity present in each cerebral hemisphere is known as the lateral ventricle. Because the cerebral hemispheres are on either side up here in your skull, so lateral. So that's why these are called lateral ventricles. So there's a right lateral ventricle and a left lateral ventricle. And again, just to kind of give you an idea, if we go back here, so imagine one lateral ventricle, another lateral ventricle, right? These two lateral ventricles will come down and communicate with a ventricle which will be called third ventricle. That third ventricle will come down and communicate with another area which we'll see, which will be called the cerebral aqueduct. So the name just keeps changing, okay? So here, let's look at that. So here we have one lateral ventricle, another lateral ventricle. These lateral ventricles, you can see, are kind of C-shaped. So, you know, it looks like it has little horns. So we give names like an anterior horn, an inferior horn, but you don't need to worry about that. Just remember it as lateral ventricles. Since there are two lateral ventricles, the next cavity which is seen is called the third ventricle. It's almost as if this is first, second, so now third ventricle. And each lateral ventricle communicates with the third ventricle because it's all one tube only, right, which went out. So that communication of the lateral ventricle with the third ventricle is known as the interventricular foramen. So here, by means of the interventricular foramen, each lateral ventricle communicates with the third ventricle. This third ventricle is seen in an area of the brain, or it's the cavity of an area of the brain, which we'll see, which is called the diencephalon. The diencephalon was the part which was kind of hidden. You can't see it from the side. You can only see it when you cut a section through the brain. The third ventricle then continues into a very, very narrow channel, which is known as the cerebral aqueduct. This cerebral aqueduct lies in a part of the brain called the midbrain. So these cavities and the names along with it tell you in which area of the brain those cavities are lying. So cerebral aqueduct is related to the midbrain. This aqueduct then flares out and becomes a big cavity which is known as the fourth ventricle, because this was third, so this one is called the fourth ventricle. And the fourth ventricle is related to three parts of the brain, an area called the pons, an area called the medulla oblongata, and the cerebellum. So the fourth ventricle is related to pons, medulla, and cerebellum. And then the fourth ventricle comes down and it continues as the central canal of the spinal cord. So the central canal is related to the spinal cord. So this is as if you were looking through the brain from the top. You can see all these ventricles. This shows you the same picture as if you were looking at the brain from the side. So here's one lateral ventricle. Remember I said it was kind of C-shaped. So we often say it has an anterior horn, an inferior horn, and a posterior horn, because these are just projections. So here's one lateral ventricle. Here's the other lateral ventricle. Both of them open into the third ventricle. Third continues into the aqueduct. which then goes into the fourth ventricle, and fourth ventricle comes down into the central canal of the spinal cord. So cerebrospinal fluid is actually manufactured inside these ventricles. But remember, I also said cerebrospinal fluid bathes the brain and spinal cord on the outside. So here we have these cavities containing CSF on the inside of the brain. They add kind of buoyancy. They also give nutrition. Waste products are also passed into it. And then we have CSF on the outside. So if you're manufacturing CSF inside these cavities, how do you transport it to the outside? There has to be some way that it has to pass out. So we actually have apertures. So can you see this area here and one area here? And somewhere on the top, so I'm going to artificially draw a central aperture like that in the fourth ventricle. So up here is the central aperture in the fourth ventricle, and this is one lateral, and there'll be another one on that side. You have three apertures in the fourth ventricle through which CSF passes out. So it passes out and now lies in the subarachnoid space, and therefore when it's lying in the subarachnoid space, that's how it's able to bathe the brain on the outside as well as the spinal cord on the outside. Got that? Okay. So you keep manufacturing CSF here. You keep passing it through all these cavities, but you also pass it out into the subarachnoid space, and this subarachnoid space is bathing the brain and spinal cord on the outside. Now you have to remove it from the subarachnoid space also, right? If you didn't remove it, what will happen? Suppose you kept manufacturing and you kept passing it out, what will happen? Pardon? Your head can't swell too much because your skull is limiting, right? So what will happen? These cavities will enlarge and this subarachnoid space will also enlarge. So you'll be compressing the brain both from outside and the inside and make it into a little shell, right? So in this subarachnoid space, when the CSF comes out, the way that CSF can actually be removed is through the, see, so it's traveling in this subarachnoid space. So through these arachnoid villi, the CSF now begins to pass into veins, and the veins then take it away from the skull. So can you see, you form it inside, circulate it, pass it into the subarachnoid space, and then keep removing it through arachnoid villi and pour that CSF into the veins, because the contents of CSF or the composition of CSF is very much like plasma, which is part of blood. So you can easily pour it into veins. So therefore, you don't make sure that you don't have too much CSF inside the cavity or too much CSF outside in the subarachnoid space. You keep the volume constant so that the brain is not covered from the outside or pushed in from the inside. Okay? Have you followed the need for these arachnoid villi? So here's what I just told you. So the CSF is produced in these two ventricles, because these are the two large ventricles. So it's produced in the lateral ventricles and in the fourth ventricles by a tuft of capillaries and those ependymal cells. And that tuft of capillaries and ependymal cells is called the choroid plexus. So it's produced up here. Then it circulates, so it, from the lateral ventricle, here's that choroid plexus, it passes into the third ventricle, comes into the aqueduct, into the fourth ventricle, down into the central canal. But some of it also passes out through those apertures in the fourth ventricle and now circulates in the subarachnoid space. And then it's absorbed through those arachnoid villi and granulations into the venous sinuses. And those venous sinuses remove the blood from the inside of the skull. So CSF is constantly being produced and constantly being removed. So the amount of CSF is kept constant. Okay? So here, let's take a quick look at how this happens. So there's no audio, but just follow it. So here's CSF being formed in the lateral ventricle, passes into the third ventricle, down the aqueduct, into the fourth central canal. From the fourth ventricle through the apertures, now it's going into the subarachnoid space. So see in the subarachnoid space. And through these arachnoid villi, it is going inside these veins from where it will be removed. Okay? So you must know these cavities in order. That means you must know lateral goes into third, goes into aqueduct, goes into fourth, and then central canal, and the three apertures, and then into the subarachnoid space and passing it out. Now, if there is a problem, if you produce too much, say there is a tumor of the choroid plexus, you're producing too much, you're producing it faster than it can be removed. Or there is a problem with circulation, so there is an obstruction somewhere, right? So suppose there's an obstruction between the third ventricle and the aqueduct. Which chambers will enlarge? Which cavities will enlarge? Suppose there's a problem between the third ventricle and the cerebral aqueduct. Which areas will enlarge? The lateral ventricles and the third ventricle, right? The chambers above, because it's like plumbing. They will enlarge. So then, again, you can have big cavities there. Or you could have a problem with absorption. Everything is going on fine, but the arachnoid villi got destroyed because maybe the child had meningitis or they did not form properly. Okay? Any of these three things can increase the amount of cerebrospinal fluid inside the cavities or in the subarachnoid space or both. And it ends up in a condition known as hydrocephalus. Cephalus for head, hydro meaning water. So it's like water in the brain. So that's what happens. Children are usually born with hydrocephalus, in which case it's called congenital hydrocephalus. And any of the three things could be. It could be a tumor. Maybe there is a problem. Part of the channels were not formed properly. There were adhesions, so it's not circulating. Or the arachnoid villi did not develop properly. You can also have it in adult life, like someone has meningitis or someone gets some tumors. Anything can happen, right? In a child, however, what happens, you remember you did it in the skeletal system, the child has fontanelles, so the skull is not fully developed. So with the result, the skull can enlarge. So that's why they have this big head, the fontanelles are separated, the cerebrospinal fluid pressure rises. So if you remember, the fontanelles will bulge at that time. And treatment obviously will be, what they do is they put a shunt. So what they do is they create an artificial opening into one of the ventricles, and then under the skin this tubing passes through, and it can either go into the peritoneal cavity or it can go into a vein, so that you are removing the CSF and you're kind of relieving the pressure. And done early, the earlier it's done, the better it is, because then you prevent brain damage.
Does it go back to normal?
Yes, if you do it well in time. So now let's look at the various parts of the brain that we just talked of, where these cavities were lying. So there are two huge parts of the brain called the cerebral hemispheres, which are these. This is one cerebral hemisphere. The other cerebral hemisphere will be on that side. So there'll be another one on that side. So left and right cerebral hemisphere, whose cavity is the lateral ventricle. Then we have an area called the diencephalon, which is this area, which is hidden inside. So when we take a sagittal section, we'll see the diencephalon. Its cavity is the third ventricle. And parts of the diencephalon are the thalamus, an area below the thalamus called hypothalamus, and an area slightly above the thalamus called the epithalamus. So you notice the word thalamus for all in the diencephalon. These are the main areas. Then we have an area called the brainstem, which is formed by the midbrain, which is also hidden inside. You can't see most of it. Pons, part of it is hidden. The rest of it you can see. And a lower part called the medulla oblongata. So the brainstem consists of the midbrain, pons, and medulla. We'll be looking at each of these parts later in detail. The cavity of the midbrain is called the cerebral aqueduct. So everywhere I'm giving you these cavities just to keep reinforcing what the cavities are, and also how the cerebrospinal fluid drains. It goes from lateral to third, third to aqueduct, aqueduct to fourth ventricle. So the cavity of the midbrain is the aqueduct, but the cavity of the pons and the medulla is the fourth ventricle. And then finally, we have another part of the brain called the cerebellum, whose cavity is also the fourth ventricle. So in other words, the fourth ventricle is related to these three structures. Part of the brainstem and another part which is called cerebellum. So here is a sagittal section of the brain. So now we can see some of these structures in more detail and also see the cavities. So here is a cerebral hemisphere. So here inside, there's a little curtain of nervous tissue called septum pellucidum. If you kind of remove this inside, I will see the lateral ventricle. So this is where the lateral ventricle will be like this inside. So that's the lateral ventricle inside. This area here, now that we have cut it, we can see the diencephalon, which consists of this egg-shaped area, which is called the thalamus. This part here is called the thalamus. Below the thalamus is this area called hypothalamus. Hypo meaning below. So here is the hypothalamus. And then we have a tiny area here, which is called epithalamus. The main structure in the epithalamus, which we'll discuss, is a gland called the pineal gland. So we have thalamus, hypothalamus, epithalamus, and these three structures form the diencephalon. All of this is related to the third ventricle. So you see what happens is that here is the lateral ventricle, if I draw it like this, and here is the lateral ventricle, and it opens into the third ventricle. Now when I take a section through like this, what happens is I'm opening up the third ventricle. So I don't see I only see the lateral walls. So therefore, this is the area which is related to the third ventricle. So the thalamus, hypothalamus, and the epithalamus, all three are related to the third ventricle. This third ventricle then passes into the aqueduct, which you can see here. Aqueduct leads into the fourth ventricle. Fourth ventricle comes down and becomes the central canal of the spinal cord. But then it also has these openings through which CSF can come into the subarachnoid space. So let's see the other areas. So let's see part of the brain stem. So this here is the midbrain. This is the anterior aspect of the midbrain. This is the posterior aspect of the midbrain. And through the cavity, through the midbrain is this aqueduct. This here is the pons. This is the medulla. And this here is the cerebellum. So notice how if we looked here, we saw how the cavity of the midbrain was the aqueduct and the fourth ventricle was related to pons, medulla and cerebellum. So here you can see this is the midbrain. Its cavity is the aqueduct, pons, medulla, cerebellum, and they are related to this fourth ventricle up here. So this tent-like cavity. So that's how the fourth ventricle is related to these three areas. So let's describe the cerebral hemisphere. So there are two hemispheres. They are separated in the center by a fissure, which is called the longitudinal fissure. So if I was to draw the other cerebral hemisphere on this side like this, with the cerebellum, so this, right, this sort of going from front to back, this deep groove, that is the longitudinal fissure. So two cerebral hemispheres separated from each other by a longitudinal fissure which goes front to back. Imagine it is lying along the sagittal suture. Both hemispheres don't lie completely separate. They are actually connected to each other by axons, which form a thick band of white matter. Those axons collectively together are called corpus callosum. So the two cerebral hemispheres are connected to each other by corpus callosum. So this is a coronal section. So the two hemispheres are connected to each other by corpus callosum. So when we take a section through, you can understand that the corpus callosum will be cut in between. And that's what you see up here. So notice this area here is called corpus callosum. So this is a band which connects one hemisphere with the other. So when it is cut, it looks like this. Each hemisphere controls the opposite side of the body. Contralateral means opposite side of the body. Contralateral means opposite side of the body. So sensations from your right side of the body will go to the left cerebral hemisphere. The left cerebral hemisphere will also control the muscles on the right side of your body. So that is what is meant by contralateral. Now, in order to make sure that you can accommodate more neurons and have, if you have more neurons, you'll have more connections. If you have more connections, you're capable of, you're more evolved, you're capable of doing more things. The surface of the cerebral hemisphere is thrown into folds and grooves. Can you see this? So these are grooves present. These grooves are known as sulci. Sulcus is singular. Sulcus means a groove. And in between the grooves, this bridge or ridge of nervous tissue is known as a gyrus. So you have these sulci, which are grooves, just so that you can increase surface area. Imagine if you had this much area and it was smooth. And now, instead, in this much area, I do this. Can you see how I've increased the surface area? So by sulci, you are increasing surface area, and the bridge of nervous tissue in between is known as gyri. Gyrus is singular. Now we'll see that the cerebral hemispheres are divided into four main lobes depending on which bones they are related to, and we use certain landmarks in order to kind of name these lobes, and I'll tell you how we use them. One interesting feature is that in part of the cerebral hemisphere, which has to do with voluntary control of muscles, and in the another part of the cerebral hemisphere, so that voluntary control of muscles meaning motor area, and in another area of the cerebral hemisphere which receives sensations, which is called the sensory area, the body is represented in an upside down fashion. So what I mean by upside down fashion is, this is the top, this part is the top, or this is superior and this is inferior. So if I was to kind of represent the body, you would expect that the head end would be here and the lower part of the body would be like that, okay? You think, because if this is superior, the muscles of the head would be controlled by this region, the muscles of your feet would be controlled by a lower area. But that's not how it is represented in the brain. It is actually represented in an upside down fashion. So the head end is actually on the inferior most part of the cerebral hemisphere, and the feet are actually represented, the knee and the feet are represented on the medial surface, with the arms somewhere here up in the middle. So that is what I mean by represented in an upside down fashion. So in other words, if somebody had a stroke and this area was damaged, then area of the face would be involved. If on the other hand somewhere here was damaged, it would be the arms and maybe the trunk region which would be involved. Okay? And another important thing for you to remember is that the representation is not based on the size of the structure. So if you think of it, the limbs, especially the lower limb is the, or lower extremity, is the largest structure in your body, right? In all of us, our lower limb, the entire going from hip to foot, that is the largest structure in your body. And let's take a look, something like the lips and the tongue, they are very, very small when you compare it to the lower limb. But the area of representation, that means on the cerebral hemisphere, each part has a certain area where it's represented. And it's given a certain amount of area. That amount is based not on how big the structure is, but how important the structure is. In other words, it's based on functional importance. If you compare the lower limb with your lips, for example, your lips are very, very important, because not only do you use them for, tasting something, for putting something in your mouth, for swallowing. I mean, you have to first put it in your mouth, and you also use them for speech. So really important. Similarly, if you can take your hand, your thumb is more important than all of the other four fingers. If you remove your thumb, you will not be able to use all of your other fingers and your hand very well. Man is, particularly Homo sapiens, the very fact that we have a thumb, That kind of helps us to grasp things and do a lot of complicated movements. Try just holding your thumb. You'll not be able to do a lot of things. Yeah, maybe you can train yourself to do some things, but otherwise, you know, it really becomes difficult. So here, if you notice, see how the face area, especially the tongue, is given so much representation. But look at the lower limb. See how little it's given. Similarly, if you look, the thumb is given a large area because the thumb is functionally more important compared to other digits. So the representation is based on functional importance rather than on size. And that's really important for you to remember. So let's take a look at the section of the cerebrum. And this is kind of a review. So if we take a look at the section, as I said, this is where that corpus callosum is. So it's a band of white matter that connects the two cerebral hemispheres with one another. In a coronal section, here is the corpus callosum. So this is the corpus callosum. So see how it's connecting the two cerebral hemispheres. Also, what I want you to review is some terms we used earlier. Remember gray matter and cortex? We used that term. So in the brain, the gray matter is peripheral, so it's on the outside. It's called gray matter. It's also known as cerebral cortex, which you can see here. But certain islands of gray matter got left behind inside in the middle, and those islands are known as nuclei. So you can see up here, head of caudate nucleus. So up here, this is the caudate nucleus. This is also a nucleus which has a different name. It's called putamen and globus pallidus, but it is the same thing. So these are areas which have cell bodies of neurons. The thalamus also is a nucleus. So you can see up here, the thalamus too will have cell bodies of neurons. And all of this other area, which is lighter in color, this is what is called white matter. And this is where as is the corpus callosum, which is also white matter. So you have axons in that area. So therefore, this is a good review for you. So here you can see peripherally you have cortex. In the center you have nuclei. Both of them contain the cell bodies of neurons. So in other words, the cell bodies will be present here. The axons will travel in this part, which is white matter. So here you'll have cell bodies. Here also cell bodies. Axons will travel like that in the white matter. Here is axons which connect two cerebral hemispheres, so that area is called corpus callosum. Also remember, in the brain you have those multipolar neurons. Remember, bipolar neurons were present in sense organs. They were sensory. Pseudo-unipolar were also sensory. But up here in the cortex you have these multipolar neurons, okay? So let's see certain sulci, gyri, and how we label these lobes of the brain. So this is the cerebral hemisphere of the other side. So this part in between, separating the two cerebral hemispheres, in between, going from the front to the back, so along the sagittal sulcus, is this longitudinal fissure. Fissure is just a deep groove. So here is this longitudinal fissure, which separates the two cerebral hemispheres from one another. And then we also have another groove up here, which is called the transverse fissure, which separates the cerebrum from the cerebellum. Cerebrum from the cerebellum. So you can understand, in that longitudinal fissure will be where that fox cerebri, that dura mater, will be. And in this transverse fissure, it will be where that tentorium cerebelli, those were those folds of dura mater which separated cerebrum from cerebellum, and then fox cerebri separated the two hemispheres from one another. There are many sulci, as you can see here, many, many sulci. Most of them are named. You don't have to know all the names. So there are some of them that you need to know, which I've kind of outlined up here. So let's take a look at the ones you need to know. So first is somewhere in the middle. This part is called the frontal pole. This part here is called the occipital pole. So this is called occipital pole. and this area here is called temporal pole. This is anterior, this is posterior. Because you know that your frontal bone is in front, so that's why frontal pole. The temporal bone on the side, where your temporal pole will be, and occipital bone is towards the back, so this is the occipital pole, the pointed ends of these lobes of the brain. So somewhere from the in the middle, from the frontal pole to the occipital pole, somewhere around the middle, the longest uninterrupted sulcus, which usually begins on the medial side, so it usually begins on the medial aspect, this longest uninterrupted sulcus is called the central sulcus because it's kind of right in the center. In front of it, if there is a sulcus, what would be a logical name to give? The sulcus lying in front of the central sulcus, what would be logical name to give it? This one. In front of central. What do you say for things which are in front? Pre, right? Pre-central. So this, you can see, would be called pre-central. What would this sulcus be, which is behind the central sulcus? Post-central. Yes, very good. So here is this central sulcus. Then we have a sulcus which goes in a horizontal fashion like this. This is lying on the lateral aspect. So this is called the lateral sulcus. Do you see this? This is the lateral sulcus. It doesn't extend all the way through. So it kind of stops short here, the lateral sulcus. We have a third sulcus which actually again begins from the medial side and comes on to the lateral aspect like this. This sulcus is called the parieto-occipital sulcus because it's between parietal and occipital lobes. Parieto-occipital sulcus. Now when we draw the cerebral hemispheres, here the cerebellum is kind of coming in the way, but when we draw the cerebral hemisphere, this is how we typically draw it. We kind of make a little notch on its inferior border. So if I show it to you here, see, notice this little notch up here, this area, okay? So I'm going to erase that. That notch, this area where it's a little bit notched, that notch is called pre-occipital notch. Pre-occipital meaning in front of the occipital lobe. So these are four landmarks we use. The central sulcus, the parieto-occipital sulcus, the lateral sulcus, and this pre-occipital notch. And let's see how we can divide the lobes. So if we take this pre-occipital notch and take it artificially, join it to this parieto-occipital sulcus. So we take this pre-occipital notch and artificially join it to the parieto-occipital sulcus. And we extend this lateral sulcus all the way back. Now we can see we have four lobes which we can delineate very well. The part in front of the central sulcus above the lateral sulcus is the frontal lobe, which, as you can see, and we'll talk about it, has this very important area called precentral gyrus. The part behind the central sulcus, above the lateral, and in front of this imaginary line is the parietal lobe, which has this post-central gyrus. Occipital lobe is behind that imaginary line which we connected. And temporal lobe is below the lateral sulcus and in front of that line. So here is temporal lobe, here is occipital, parietal and frontal, and they are related to those cranial bones. So frontal is related mainly to frontal bone, parietal mainly to parietal, occipital to occipital bone, temporal mainly to the temporal bone. If I was to kind of take this lateral sulcus and open up the lips of the lateral sulcus, deep inside I will see a part of the brain called the insula. It's kind of buried inside. We can't see it, but it's kind of deep inside. So some people use the insula as a separate lobe. But for your purposes, we are going to use these four lobes. As always, whenever you're doing structures, we always want to know functions. So you classify them or find ways to identify them, and you must know functions. Frontal lobe, that precentral gyrus, which I just pointed out to you, this precentral gyrus, this one here, this precentral gyrus, this is the primary motor area of the brain. This is the one which controls voluntary movement. But remember, the control is on the opposite side of the body. So in other words, the right precentral gyrus will control voluntary movement of muscles in on the left side of the body. Then we have an area which is in front of the precentral gyrus. So there's an area in front of the precentral gyrus which is known as the premotor area. Pre meaning in front of the motor, okay? Then we'll also have an area up here which is called prefrontal cortex. And we'll see some area here which is called the Broca's area. So let me first just name them and tell you about them, and we'll look at these areas. So that motor cortex is that precentral gyrus controls voluntary movement on the opposite side of the body. The premotor area, which is in front of this, this is the one which is really important for you to do very skilled motor activity and, you know, to plan your tasks and to do complex things, you know, like multitasking, doing things together, like, you know, mixing something, pouring it, using two, three things together, or pouring from one glass to another. When you do all these kind of complex activities, that planning and everything goes on in this premotor area. Then in this frontal lobe, we have an area which is called Broca's area, which is called motor speech. Now that I'm talking, that is because my motor speech area is working properly. It is able to give commands to my the area of on the precentral gyrus, which controls my lips and my tongue and my larynx, and so I'm able to articulate my words properly. If this motor speech area was lost, the person knows what they want to say, but they are not able to articulate their words properly. So I would not be talking like that. That's how I would be talking. Okay, so if my Broca's area was gone, that's how I would talk. I know exactly what I want to say, but I'm not able to get my tongue and my lips and my larynx to work together because that area is damaged. So it's not able to pass the messages on. Then in front, the absolute front of your frontal area is called the prefrontal cortex. This is the area where judgment, intellect, social behavior, acting in a particular way, you know, we have certain inhibitions. You don't sit in any odd fashion. You don't do what you want in, you know, when you're sitting here, when you go in society, the way you behave, all of this is important. And that's where this prefrontal cortex. And they actually found out this. I mean, I don't know how many of you have seen the movie One Who Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest. Has anybody seen that movie? If not, yeah, good. Go and see it. So there is this guy, Jack Nicholson, who, you know, who's sort of, he's locked up in this asylum. And then, you know, he troubles the lady inside who's the nurse and all that. So they do something called a prefrontal lobotomy. So what they do is they cut the prefrontal lobe, they cut the connections. So with the result, his motor judgment and everything is gone. So he's pretty much like a vegetable. And he has a friend in that who's a Native American and who finally kills him because he can't see him, you know, now living his life like a vegetable. So that, you know, that's the movie. So if you haven't seen the movie, it's a nice movie to see. But otherwise, the way they found out that this prefrontal cortex was responsible for all this was because many years ago, there was a guy called Phineas Gage, and he was employed in a railroad company, and they used to blast dynamite when they used to lay down tracks. So this guy, you know, those days they used to use a tamping rod, and that's how they used to blast dynamite. So this guy was doing that, and, you know, it exploded before it should have. And the tamping rod went through his orbit. So it kind of, if you look at his face like this, okay, and these are his eyes. So it kind of went through this area like this, and it went through his prefrontal cortex. And he survived. despite all the, you know, we didn't have such good infection control and all that, he survived. But he had a absolutely drastic change of temperament. He sort of began to have a very mercurial temper. He sort of would get angry and talk nonsense on, he was provoked by little things. He became very unhygienic, started doing crazy things like, you know, defecating in public or urinating in public, talking nonsense. And all of this was because that prefrontal cortex was gone. And then, I mean, he had to leave that company, and apparently he ended up joining a freak show. So it's a very sad story, but then that's how they kind of came to know that all this happens. This also explains why, because the prefrontal cortex is the last part of the brain to develop. Myelination starts from the back to the front. So myelination begins in the occipital lobe and travels all the way to the front to the prefrontal area. Prefrontal is one of the later areas to develop. So it develops by about 24 years, or 24, 25. This is the reason why teenagers do not exercise good judgment, because their prefrontal cortex has not developed at all. So, you know, when you ask them, what were you thinking? They weren't really thinking because they're not capable at that time. And it's not a joke. It's true. I mean, don't let them use that as an excuse that, oh, my prefrontal cortex is not developed, so, you know, I can't judge. But that's the reason why that, you know, they're not able to exhibit that judgment which many of us, you know, when we get older are able to exhibit. So that's the prefrontal cortex. And then this frontal lobe is also important in controlling voluntary eye movement. So all of this, you can see, is a lot of it has to do with motor activities. When we take the parietal lobe, which lies behind the central sulcus, this has to do with sensations. So primary sensory area. So that post-central gyrus is where sensations are processed. So again, from the, if you prick your right finger, right thumb, the sensations will travel to the left post-central gyrus, and there you will perceive that pain. So, or if there's hot, something hot is put on your hand. So the sensations are, that's where they are perceived. This is also the area where if you close your eyes and I put something in your hand, a familiar object in your hand, if I put a sponge in your hand, or I put a dime, or I put a quarter in your hand, or I put a dollar bill, or I put a rock, I put any of these familiar objects in your hand with your eyes closed, you would be able to tell me just by shape, texture, and feel what that object is, right? So, you know, if I put an orange or an apple, most times you can tell me what it is in your hand. This ability to tell familiar objects by feeling them without looking at them, by shape and structure, is known as stereognosis. So if the parietal lobe is damaged and a person's eye is closed and you put a familiar object in their hand, they will not be able to tell you what it is. So that process is called astereognosis. This area, parietal lobe, is also important because it helps you to differentiate between the left side and the right side of your body. It also helps you to tell where you are. I mean, I know in a huge parking lot, we often forget where we've parked our car. That's just because it's so big that we forget. But then, you know, we use certain landmarks and we're able to find our way there. So that is what is called spatial relationship, being able to tell in space, you know, where things are. When people have parietal lobe problems, they are actually lose their way in their own house. They don't know where the bathroom is in their own house. They don't even recognize the left side, depending on which side is damaged. They don't recognize that side of the body. So if they were to apply makeup, they assume that that side doesn't exist. So they will only apply makeup on one side, or they'll only shave their beards on one side. So that spatial relationship is gone. Then the parietal lobe is also important for perceiving taste. So you can see a lot of sensations. So we had sensory area, taste, and then we have a small part in this area which is important for sensory speech. This area is called Wernicke's area. Like the motor speech was called Broca's, this is called Wernicke's. By sensory speech, I mean comprehension. That means being able to understand. Sensory speech is comprehension. So if I tell, you know, you hopefully you're all understanding what I'm saying, right? And if I asked you to repeat, where is the sensory area, where is this Wernicke's area present, you would say parietal lobe. Someone who has a damage in this area, if I ask them, what is the weather, they'll give me some kind of reply which will be articulated properly but has no connection to what I've said because they haven't understood what I've asked. So ask them, what is the weather? They might say, the flight takes off at 10 o'clock. No, there's no connection at all because they haven't understood. But can you see they are talking properly as compared to someone with Broca's who understands what you're saying but is not able to articulate properly? Next lobe is temporal lobe. This area, very, very important also. This is responsible for hearing. So auditory sensations are perceived here for hearing. Now, hearing is a bit complicated. It's kind of represented in both cerebral hemispheres. So one temporal lobe actually gets sensations from both ears, but otherwise it's still responsible for hearing. That sensory speech, which I just talked about, most of it, the main part of the sensory speech is in the temporal lobe. A small part is present in parietal, but mainly in the temporal lobe. This lobe is also responsible for smell, also responsible for memory functions, for emotions, because it is connected with a system known as the limbic system. And this limbic system has to do with emotion, certain inborn traits like maternal instinct, nurturing, sexual libido. All of this is part of the limbic system. So the temporal lobe is kind of connected to the limbic system, so has these functions incorporated into it. The occipital lobe, its primary function is vision, the perception of vision. And in vision, actually, it isn't as if the right occipital lobe goes, if it's damaged, that means you will lose sight from your left eye, because we said, you know, it's opposite. It is what is called field of vision. So when you look at an object, there's a right side to the object, there's a left side to the object. We call it right field of vision and left field of vision. So in vision, we will see when we do the visual pathway, that in vision, it is one occipital cortex is responsible for the opposite field of vision in both eyes. So for example, if my right occipital cortex was damaged, I would lose the left field of vision from both eyes. Okay, so it is the field of vision which it is responsible for. And associated visual functions are like when you look at something like red, for example, it signifies danger to you. Or you look at some beautiful color, it sort of sets up some reactions inside you. So these are visual intertwined functions which are known as associated visual functions. This picture up here shows you these various lobes and all the functions that are there. So, you know, I've kind of highlighted this. So everything that I told you is highlighted. So up here you can see pre-central gyrus, the motor area, post-central, which is the sensory area, and this is the prefrontal cortex, which had to do with intellect and judgment. This area up here is what is called Broca's area, which is for motor speech. So this is the Broca's area, and up here you have the Wernicke's area. So you can see this Wernicke's area. Most of it is present in the temporal lobe, a little bit in the parietal lobe. This part here is for vision, so this is the primary visual cortex. So kind of take a look at this image really well so that you are able to understand all these functions. So you must know all these functions of these various lobes. So let's just review these functional areas.
Cerebrum, the anterior or front and largest part of the brain, consisting of two halves or hemispheres, and serving to control voluntary movements and coordinate mental actions. Cerebellum, a large portion of the brain serving to coordinate voluntary movements, posture, and balance in humans, being in the back and below the cerebrum and consisting of two lateral lobes and a central lobe. Corpus callosum. It connects the left and right cerebral hemispheres and facilitates interhemispheric communication. Brainstem. The portion of the brain that is continuous with the spinal cord. It controls reflexes and such essential internal mechanisms as respiration or breathing and heartbeat. Spinal cord. The thick column of nerve tissue that extends from the base of the brain about two-thirds of the way down the backbone. As part of the central nervous system, it carries impulses back and forth between the brain and other parts of the body through a network of nerves that extend out from it like branches. Sight area, the area responsible for vision. This is why a bang at the back of the head can make you see stars. Touch. This is responsible for touch, especially fingers and around the mouth. Motor area. Responsible for muscle coordination. Speech center. This is obviously responsible for speech. Hearing center. The area connected to your ears. Taste. The area connected directly to your tongue. Balance and coordination.
He's got taste and hearing mixed up because taste is in the parietal lobe and hearing is in the temporal lobe, so he's got it a little mixed up there.
Connected to part of your ears and responsible for keeping your balance.